When it comes to software, there's code, which developers work on, and infrastructure, which operations works on. Sentry focuses on the code layer, which is typically the fastest changing layer and typically the area that's least monitored. Sentry focuses on arming the developers with the context and workflow they need to be as productive as possible. Now that Sentry is set up on my applications, let's put ourselves in the shoes of the developer. We have two unrelated critical issues affecting the user experience. Sentry will help me see and solve both of them within 5 minutes without me having to dig and ask questions. Then we're going to find some application level optimizations via Sentry's guided performance workflows. Alrighty, let's go and try to buy a bunch of expensive plants. It looks like there's a massive slowdown when we try to look at all of the plant products. We have no idea what's causing this slowdown. It could be the front end, middle tier, back end, database, or combination of those. More importantly, it looks like there's an error after we added over $1,000 worth of plant products and attempt to check out. This means we're unable to fulfill purchases and therefore not taking in revenue. Since I'm using Sentry, I've automatically been notified that errors are occurring in both my front end and back end, as well as there are some performance problems. Let's start with debugging the front end error. It looks like we have a 500 error in our checkout page that occurs quite often and affects many users. It started happening in our 24.1.3 release, and it's still happening in 24.2.2. We can also create a corresponding issue in Jira or other project management platforms directly from here. It looks like this error affected all types of browsers across 2 releases in production and all types of customers. This is a critical issue. Let's examine a specific event to gain more insight into what's happening. We can see all the specific attributes, and underneath that, we have the enriched and deobfuscated stack trace. We can see the lines where the issue is occurring in each frame, as well as a few lines before and after. We then use this to intelligently group errors. We can also see that the code responsible for this error was untested via our integration with CodeCov. So in this case, we should write a test when resolving this to ensure we don't regress here. We can also hop directly into GitHub or CodeCov from within the stack trace. We have session replay as well, which I'll circle back to in just a moment. The steps leading up to this error are documented as breadcrumbs. In this case, we can see that the user clicked submit on the checkout page, then we received a 500 response from one of our services, and an error bubbled up to the front end. The stack trace also validates this. As I mentioned earlier, Sentry doesn't just help developers see issues in real time, it helps them solve them in record time. We can leverage AI to suggest a fix for this problem right here. In this case, AI will validate the problem was actually within the downstream service that's responding to the request, and also tells us how to handle this better on the front end. Any other information that might be relevant to the developer will be captured below. To help developers solve and get on the right track, Sentry integrates with source code management platforms such as GitHub to surface the change and the code owner so that we can loop in the developer who has the most context and the best chance of fixing the problem in the shortest possible time. Now, taking a step back, with all of the context, we can confidently establish that the broken checkout was caused by something going wrong on the back end. Sentry links errors across services, so we can easily trace an error downstream with one click. In this case, I'm jumping from the React error on the checkout page to the Flask error on the checkout endpoint. Looking at the stack trace, we can see that we didn't have enough inventory for the purchase items. Therefore, an error was thrown. We can even inspect the variable values in Python so that we get a deeper understanding. So in this case, it was this specific commit that caused the issue, and therefore its author should be the one that fixes this. Once fixed, our application will function as expected and purchases can be fulfilled successfully. In the case where these events do not provide the needed metadata to start solving the problem, we can then take a look at the session replay to see exactly what the user did so we can reproduce if needed and understand what the impact on the user experience was. Here, we have a video-like reproduction where we can inspect the DOM as needed. We also see all the corresponding breadcrumbs, console log, network log, associated errors, entire trace which shows the entire journey including where the errors occurred, memory usage, and corresponding tags. Now that we understand what's wrong with our broken checkout experience, let's debug the slowdown in rendering and loading all of our products. In this case, Sentry has notified us that we have a slow database query, and specifically an N+1 query that is causing a slowdown and should be addressed. So rather than just telling the developer that the page is slow to load, or an API endpoint is slow to respond, Sentry is saying that the slowdown is due to a specific problematic pattern that needs to be addressed or optimized. Let's dig into this N+1 query. We can see that this N+1 issue has been happening very often, and Sentry has pointed out the problematic spans, specifically the repeating inefficient requests. Let's head to the transaction to see what's happening in the larger picture. We can once again see the N+1 issue. Optimizing those queries into a single query will help shave off about half of a second. Digging into this a bit deeper, we can see that the Git iterator is taking about 2 seconds, and that this is actually the most significant contributor to the product's endpoint being slow. This is as far as distributed tracing would take you. We've identified a slow span, but we would need to instrument more to get further clarity. This is where profiling comes in. A developer can dive in directly to the profile from within a span in Sentry. Now we're presented a flame graph that shows the call stack and the timings associated to each function call. Looks like the Git iterator function is recursing excessively, which needs to be addressed. We can also jump directly into the code from within here. As a developer, Sentry has helped me find exactly where and why the slowdowns are happening and resolve them in record time by pointing out the known performance issues and directing the developer to the code responsible for it. Sentry also will identify datasets of interest. Here we can see suspect spans, tags, and functions that are likely contributing to the user experience slowdown. In this case, Sentry has surfaced the specific span and function we looked at previously. Thus far, we've responded to some issues that Sentry has flagged and alerted us on. Let's use Sentry to find out what and where developers should optimize to yield a better and more performant user experience. Let's begin with finding out what can be improved regarding user perceived performance on the front end. It looks like we have a performance score of 90. That is being brought down by the less than ideal largest contentful paint web vital. We are then presented with the pages that have compromised LCP. In this case, we can see that our highly trafficked products page has a poor LCP and ample room for improvement. We are then presented samples that exemplify the poor web vital so that we can move on to understanding what exactly happened. In this case, we can see that the LCP was quite high, and it looks like it was our slow request to the product's endpoint, which was slowed due to the N+1 query and out of control recursion. And that is what's resulting in this slow user experience. Now let's go through a similar guided workflow, but this time for queries to our database. Here we see our database queries, ordered by the cumulative time spent. Looks like this frequented query can be optimized more as it's taking a long amount of time. Let's dig in. We then are presented with exactly in the code where the query is being issued, as well as the endpoints that leverage the query. Clicking into the endpoint, we are presented with the relevant samples that takes us to the span in question. Once again, we see that the query is problematic due to the inefficient N+1 queries. Up until now, I've showcased how developers can use Sentry to react to issues as well as find areas to optimize. Sentry also lets developers quickly slice and dice data and create relevant alerts and dashboards. Let's break down the error count by different customer types, and then set an alert for enterprise customers experiencing errors. We can also add this to a dashboard directly from the query. Here is an example dashboard where we can see session health metrics, errors, and performance data all in one place. We can also drill down from here as needed. That's all I had to show you today. In summary, exception and performance issues were brought to our attention in real time, and we solved them in record time. We found precisely the root cause of the error, the code responsible, as well as its author that can rapidly fix it. We found out exactly why the code was slow, whether it was a problematic pattern such as an N+1, or by using profiling to see why specific code or functions were inefficient. We also identified a poor performance score and a poor performing query, allowing us to find key areas to optimize. Lastly, we used Sentry to slice and dice data, set up an alert, and visualize various data sets within a dashboard. In conclusion, Sentry helps developers be productive by helping them see and solve issues as efficiently as possible, thus increasing their productivity and improving application uptime and quality.